everyone. My name is Liz Diaz. I am a hairstylist, a journalist, and co-founder of Beyond Beauty School. Today I have the privilege of sitting here with entrepreneur, philanthropist, father, co-founder of Paul Mitchell Systems, and someone I personally idolize, Mr. John Paul DeJoria. Thank you so much for being here. Even letting me be here, actually.
Yeah, well, my pleasure. And you have such a great message to get out through your system. I think it's wonderful. So it's my pleasure being here. And I hope 20,000 times more people that watch your program right now watch it here in the future, because I think it's really great what you're doing, what you're writing about our industry.
I am very excited and just so humbled and honored to be able to sit here with you today. And you are just such a ball of energy, and like you seem like you're always so happy and so positive. Like, how do you always stay excited?
Interesting question. I've been asked that before. I think it's just my general nature. I was just kind of born that way, because as a kid, I was always pretty excited. In fact, I was the boy in my day when I went to school, which is before your parents' day when they went to school. I'd be the kid they'd stick in the very back of the class. I think today they give them, drugs to calm kids down. But I was just so full. I couldn't stop talking, and I wanted to move around and do things. I was just a little wiry for a good portion of my life, but I was happy. And I think a lot of that has to do with my parents, or my mom, I should say, she raised my brother and I. Yeah. We had absolutely nothing, but didn't know we had absolutely nothing, because we had tons of love, and my mom was just the most positive person. So when you grow up in an environment like that, and you have this extra energy, they combine together, and just, I'm a happy person. I'm very, very fortunate to be a happy person.
Yeah, I mean, I've read your story and how, like, you guys grew up in poverty, and how your mom was such a huge influence in your life, and it seemed like you had many times where you did struggle. But I'm curious, like, how did you cultivate a mindset that didn't allow for doubt? Like, is there like a mantra or daily affirmations you do?
Not really. I think also that contributed, what contributed to it is, there have been several times in my life where I've been really down and out, whether it was homeless, or let's say the family member one week and only had 27 cents between my brother, my mother, and I. So we were really down and out, but the way my mother approached it was, and I give her so much credit for this, was, hey boys, what do we have all together? 27 cents, but we have food in the refrigerator, and I get a paycheck on Monday, and we're healthy. Boy, are we lucky, wonderful people. Yeah, Mom, great. We went into our little garden, picked some vegetables. So things like that when you're down and out. When I was homeless, you can't get any lower than being homeless in your car. I guess you could, being homeless under a bridge.
Yeah.
But when you're that low, all you should think about is not, oh God, what got me here, how terrible life is, but only thing I can think about is, okay, how do I get money to eat? You know, that's the next step. So when you think ahead and things are down and out, it's a little bit easier. But I'd say 99% of the time I'm a very, very happy person.
Yeah.
Very grateful and gratitude.
And I think that like is a rarity to see in people, to be honest. I feel like a lot of people do hold on to like the things that hold them back and not necessarily like focus on the things that can move them forward.
Sure.
So with that, I mean, like, what do you consider a productive day? But like John Paul, like 1980, when you're building John Paul Mitchell Systems, and then John Paul, like 2019.
Oh boy, talk about a difference. So let's say when we first started building the company, I would, my story tells you, look at Good Fortune, the documentary, and I'll give you a copy here.
Beautiful, yes.
Anyways, I get up in the morning, and I kind of wake up and I look around, and I'm in my car, and I'm parked on Mulholland Drive, and then I usually will make one of my stops of going down to Griffith Park, and I shower down there in the tennis courts, it was free, and go to the Freeway Cafe. For 99 cents, you would have one egg, one piece of toast, either coffee or orange juice, and either one piece of sausage, or one piece of bacon, and they called it the trucker special. If you went after 9 o'clock, where they had no business from 9 to 10, that's what you got for 99 cents.
Sounds like a Happy Meal.
That's how I started my day off. And then I would drive in the early days straight down Ventura Boulevard in Los Angeles, where I lived, and I'd call on beauty salon to beauty salon. We decided, since I was in the beauty industry previously and my partner was a top hairdresser, and that we would just stay in the professional beauty industry. We knew that industry. So I called on salons door to door, trying to sell them our first three products, shampoo one, shampoo two, and the conditioner. 3 months later, we had something we called the sculpting lotion we invented. That was a little more helpful. So we would do that, and at the time, you know, collect a check, get our money. Sometimes I would go down to our filling facility that filled our product to check on things. Other times I'd help them deliver it.
And then all here in LA too?
All here, yeah. We started in LA, had no money. And Paul lived in Hawaii, I lived here.
Oh, okay.
And then, after the first few months, Paul was booked for a few shows in the United States. I would go there with Paul, we'd bring our product and sell it during the show.
How fun are the hair shows, by the way? They're so much fun, aren't
they? Oh, they were. We had a really good time. We love the industry. Yeah. Many people asked me, especially with Patron, I started Patron in 89, and they said, well, JP, Patron is very, very large, much larger than Paul Mitchell now, but why do you spend the majority of your working time doing philanthropic things and advisors and just being around hairdressers in your life? And I say, because they're some of the funnest people on the planet. They're just great. And here it is today. We're 39 years old.
Amazing.
In January, we've been in business 40 years.
That is incredible.
Yeah, and of course, we have other greater people than me that run the business every day, but I'm still chairman of the board, advisor, and I head up, shall we say, our worldwide culture.
That's awesome. What are you guys going to do to celebrate 40 years? That's incredible.
Yes, we're going to go to Hawaii, where we first started out with a little meeting in a hotel room, one little hotel room with two distributors, how we started out.
Yeah.
We're going to go to Hawaii and have a nice little presentation for all of our distributors, and a big thank you to our top educators and our distributors, and make it a year of celebration for being in the beauty industry.
So you guys still have a big facility in Hawaii.
What we have in Hawaii is in Paliula, which is one of the towns on the upper north coast. We have an avapui farm where we grow avapui ourselves. We process it through solar energy units to dry through solar energy, and we also collect it in the wild. And our farm there, people come and visit. It's pretty cool. It's self-sufficient, runs off solar energy, and it has a lot of vegetables there. And
you guys started that pretty early on, though, before a lot of people started getting on board with the solar energy, didn't you?
Boy, did you do your homework. Yes, we did. Our second year in business, Paul and I were able to make enough money where we distributed $2,000 each to us, like as a dividend. We thought, we haven't made.
Yeah.
Our bills were paid on time. So the next year, we thought, okay, hopefully this will last a long time, but we don't know. So let's take some of our money that we made in our third year, and we bought this property in Hawaii, fairly reasonable. We thought, okay, worst scenario, we'll have a place to live when we get older, right? And Paul, on your side, you built your house, you live there with your wife or girlfriend, I'll do the same on my side of the land. And we built Balinese houses, and we had water on the land, and solar energy, and started planting vegetables. We'll be self-sufficient. If everything goes wrong, at least at our older age, we'll be okay.
So,
and that's how it all started
that
there.
That is like incredible. And you know, how important are like your instincts when you're thinking like something's gonna hit gold, or like this is like the right track to go? Like, do you go like more facts or more like hunches?
Well, many times I've gone with what I thought was fact, and sometimes what I thought were pretty good hunches, and I didn't do so well.
Yeah.
But I'm very fortunate that more than 50% of the time I did do very, very well.
Yeah.
And I'm finding out more recently in my life, the last couple of years, that you try not to just think with your brain, but think with your heart.
Right.
How do you feel about the situation? How do you feel about the people? No matter how kind they are. And I've had some really nice people, got in foreign countries and everything else, that were the nicest people in the world, turned out to be total ripoffs.
Yeah.
But I didn't know that. There were clues along the way. So I say to everybody, and I say to myself now, feel the person out or feel the situation out with your heart. What is your instinct? I think now more in life that I go off instinct plus facts. Obviously, you have to have some facts along with it.
Does it become easier the more you do it?
Yep.
Okay.
Much easier. When you're set to, well, how do I feel about this? Shall we say, with data, stable data that I have, how do I feel about these facts? And then how I feel about it, just my intuition, how do I feel about it from my heart?
Yeah.
And the more you think about doing it that way, the more it happens.
So, I mean, do you consider the creative process like the hardest part of like all of these different business ventures that you've done? Or
I'd say that, and I try and give this advice to everybody, when you do various business ventures, at first, I did a lot I wasn't passionate about, but I did because they sounded like a good thing.
Yeah.
No, go with the heart what you're passionate about. And if I could share with your audience two very important things for anything you do in my industry, our industry, the beauty industry, any other industry, two keys to extreme success. One is be prepared for a lot of rejection.
Yes.
People aren't. Something goes wrong. Whether you're a hairdresser and you're not booked as much as you want the first 2 months, or you're doing something else in life, it's not going your way. Or people say you can't do it, or this is wrong, or no, you're too late in the game, you don't have enough money, you know, you're too old, you're too anything other than, yay, let's go. Be prepared for that, because in life there's a lot of rejection. If you're prepared for it, it's not going to hurt you. Right. When you get that rejection, it's, well, I was preparing for it anyways. Example I like to give. I sold encyclopedias door-to-door in my early 20s, commission only. Mm-hmm. I would knock on 50 doors, they'd be closed in my face. But I'd be just as enthusiastic, let's say on door number 51 or 151, as I was in the first door. And finally, you learn how to do it. Then you get more confidence and you learn. So one is be prepared for a lot of rejection. The other is make sure the service you offer or the product you make, either one, either your personal service as an employee or as a partner, or the product you make, make sure it's of the highest quality, because you don't want to be in the selling business. You don't want to keep selling yourself or selling your product. You want to be in the resale business, reorder, which means that your product is so good, or your service or your value to your organization is so good, you don't have to keep selling yourself. People want to reorder. They want to reorder your service. They want to reorder your product. Two very, very good keys. And needless to say, successful people do all the things unsuccessful people don't want to do.
Absolutely.
Work the extra hours, work the extra time, and don't give up on yourself.
Yeah, I mean, now with like technology, social media and stuff, it's so easy for people to find a new hairdresser to go to, or a new business to go to, or a new product to try. So you really have to make each person like just as valuable as door number one, right?
That is correct.
Yeah. So I actually have this. I wanted to show you.
Okay. My friends call me JP.
Yeah, great. I got this book. And it, I love that this reminds me of like the old school encyclopedias that had the card cover like this. I had a million of these growing up with my grandmother. So there was one picture I found in here that I thought was pretty cool. And it was this picture.
Oh, Paul. Yes.
Paul doing hair in Miami, because you guys met at the Fountain Blue
Hotel. I met him at the Fountain Blue in Miami. That's correct. 1971.
So this is like before Scarface. So you guys definitely set the way for them to go film there, right?
That's correct. Hey, you're right, though.
Yeah, actually, my first time in Miami was... I stayed at the Fountain Blue Hotel 3 years ago, so it was a pretty cool experience. So what was it like meeting him for the first time at the hair show? And
I've been in the industry for several months, and it was a Barber and Beauty Supply Institute convention, where it was big distributors, manufacturers, a lot of the top hairdressers. Paul was doing shows for Lean Curtis and some other companies at the time, and we had a mutual friend, Eva Prang. And I had met her, because I was working for a hair care company at the time, in sales, obviously. And she said, JP, you got to meet my friend Paul Mitchell. I said, I've heard of him. The great hairdresser does shows. Yeah, you two will end up being the best of friends. I met Paul, and we ended up being the best of friends. So 9 years after being the very, very best of friends, we actually started our own business together.
That's amazing. And so, like, what was the dynamic like in the beginning of your business relationship?
It was great, because Paul wasn't a business person, but a great hairstylist.
Right.
I was a business person, a marketing person, and connected in the industry, but I didn't do hair. And we were the best of friends. It was the most perfect partnership. I didn't do hair, he didn't do business. We had never had anything that we would argue about. There was nothing to argue about, nothing not to go along with the other. Paul and I have never, ever had an argument, never.
Wow.
Never. He was my brother, my friend, you know, my super buddy, my business partner, and we respected one another, and we just got along great. It
so
was fabulous.
It was easy
and we
for
built
you guys
a business.
To trust each other too.
Yeah. Exactly.
What advice would you give to business owners that do have like co-partners and like handling disagreements?
I have had before co-partners in some businesses I've tried. And not as good as my partner, Paul Mitchell, but in other businesses, and they didn't turn out to be what I thought they would be. So if you have a partner, one, you've got to be friendly to one another. You also have to have your boundaries where, okay, I live my life, you live your life, we can't live it all together. We're together, we have a certain goal. Now, if you do have, I call it a challenge opposed to a problem, the best way to address it is not do it, for example, aggressively. In other words, don't attack on it.
Right.
Instead, it's much easier to say, Well, you know, Liz, you're a wonderful person. We've done some really great business together. But with all due respect, when I came in here, I had a great idea I wanted to tell you, and you kept on cutting me off. And it made me feel bad, Liz, you know? I just want to let you know, it just made me feel bad. And I know you're like to hear it. I just wanted to share that with you. Right. You share your feelings with the person. If they have an idea you don't think is any good, you can say, you know, that's a great idea. I could appreciate where you're coming from. Always validate the person. However, can we look at this a little differently? Maybe we can enhance it and build upon it. Absolutely. And then you come in with your two cents. Always respect the other person.
Yeah. And that goes along with like your coworkers too, anybody else that you work with, you want to kind of give them that same kind of respect too.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. And I'd say in my training programs, whether it's the FBI, the CIA, or universities throughout the nation, or sometimes many countries put things together for me, for entrepreneurs, I tell them all the same exact thing when it comes to relationships. We are all people. Mm-hmm. Each one of us are special. We have to remember how special the other person is. And sometimes we slip. But when you find out, go back to successful people do the things unsuccessful people don't want to do. So for everyone in your audience, I will share this with coworkers or if you're in management. Whenever you reprimand somebody, they goofed up, right? Mm-hmm. You never ever reprimand them in public. You always reprimand them behind closed doors, one-on-one.
Yeah.
The minute you tell somebody off or put them down in public or there's anyone around listening, they're going to hate you, and that's covert hostility. They will stab you in the back just to get even without you ever knowing it. So how do you reprimand somebody and make them feel good? Usually when someone tells you off or you didn't do a good job, you feel bad that whole day.
Right.
There's a way to do what you feel good. It's three things.
The but have
effect. Yep. Mm-hmm. Have it ready, though, before they walk in.
Yeah.
Number one, tell them what it was they didn't do, but how you want it done. Now, it could be they didn't know how to do it, so maybe they weren't right. But here's how I'd like it done. Second thing is show them exactly why you want it done that way so they understand it, okay? Third and most important, have something ready in your arsenal before they leave, something they're already doing good. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, by gosh, Liz, you're one of the greatest interviewers on the planet, okay? Someone as good as you are and with what magnificence that comes out of you, I would automatically think you'd let me finish my sentence. You're incredible. So they leave feeling like they're worthwhile.
Yeah.
Very important. It's the opposite for praising somebody. Do it in public or at least in front of another person where someone else can hear and the person you're praising realizes someone else is listening. Mm-hmm. Nothing like praise in front of other people.
Absolutely. I mean, I remember there was a time in the salon a few years ago and I was talking to the receptionist about how she answered the phone and I remembered listening to a talk that you said, smile answering the phone, but I did the whole sandwich effect. Like, you do a really, really great job. Can you smile when you answer the phone?
Yeah.
That way they feel special and like you're doing amazing at your work or whatever it was, you know? So, and actually it worked pretty effectively.
Right.
So, and every time she answered the phone here on out was her answering the phone with a smile. So that was pretty cool. But shifting gears and speaking about the salon, my beautiful friend Lisa Butts, one of your workers here at John Paul Digital Systems, came into our salon a few months ago and brought in the new marula oil, which I'm obsessed with. I put it on my hair this morning. I even put it on my skin. It smells amazing. But I heard there's a bit of a story behind how you found the marula oil with like Foods for Africa. Can you tell that story?
Certainly. A friend of mine, knowing I was very much involved with, and with our schools are also involved in feeding children in Africa through Food for Africa, said, JP, here's something interesting coming from Africa, from South Africa and Zimbabwe. This doctor friend of mine gave me this oil, and he's a plastic surgeon, you know, top surgeon, and he uses it to heal burns quicker or surgeries quicker. Mm-hmm. So he gave it to his wife, right? It's, they're using it for skin now. It's very, very good for skin, this thing called marula oil. So he gave it to his wife. His wife put it on her face and also got on her hair. She thought, oh my God, I got this oil on my hair, on one side of her hair. And her hair was a bit on the damaged side. She went and showered it off. You know, you shower a little shampoo.
Yeah.
And when she got it, she was messing with her hair. And this side here felt better than the other side. It was like, wow. And it's not even oily anymore. What is this? So they told my friend brought it to me and we started experimenting with marula oil and found out that it does more for the hair, rebuilding hair, putting moisture in hair and structuring hair than any other oil on the market today. You know, at this time, there's some great oils out there. You know, it outperformed. It was like, this is incredible.
Yeah.
So we made a line around it.
That's amazing. And I love it. It smells so good. How long has it been available now?
I think we launched about 2.5 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Approximately.
Yeah, and there's like 4 or 5 styling products and like two different sets of shampoos.
That is correct. And it's a nice, it's a very high end. And it's as down to earth as you could get. You know, there's no sulfates, no, all the stuff you don't want in there, the parabens aren't in there.
Yeah, exactly. And you can definitely feel it on your hair.
It's and your skin. Soft. Like you've already tried, well, your skin is like a baby, so you don't count. But find someone that has lines or wrinkles, give them a little bit on their skin. It's after 2 or 3 days. Put a little bit on at night, and after 2 or 3 days, you notice a physical difference.
That's amazing.
It's good stuff.
Yeah, well, I did that this morning.
So that's how we got to Marula Oil.
Yeah, I love it. So, I mean, obviously you're a huge philanthropist and you found this with the Foods for Africa and you have the Peace and Love and Happiness Foundation of your own, which is incredible. You've had it for over 30 years, right?
The actual organization was started, I think about 17 years ago when Gary and I started the Peace, Love, and Happiness Ride. Mm-hmm. And then just shortly thereafter, we started the whole Peace, Love, and Happiness Foundation.
Like motorcycle ride, not like Ferris wheel ride.
Motorcycle riding. It was my birthday, and I don't celebrate my birthdays. To me, every day is my birthday. Yeah. So my friend Gary said, JP, let's start a motorcycle ride. How about it? And we'll raise a little bit of money and give it to the Austin Children's Shelter for abused, neglected children. And then later went to Club 100 for first responders, firemen, paramedics, law enforcement that are injured or killed in line of duty. So myself and Gary underwrote the whole thing. We paid for it all. Mm-hmm. And every dime raised went directly to the charity. We thought, this is wonderful. And a lot of our school owners come in for this, a lot of stylists, distributors, and just good friends that are entertainers throughout the world come on in for this. We have a great time, several days together, good concerts, and we have a good time. It's giving back.
It's incredible. I mean, and I know that you work a lot with like Sea Shepherd. That's like super near and dear to your heart. And I recently read that the Paul Mitchell Schools donated over $400,000 over the course of 4 years to the Thirst Project, which was pretty incredible. Eden Sassoon was the one that posted that on Instagram. I saw that like 3 days ago. So how do you decide like what organizations you want to donate your time to or donate money to or your schools?
Great question. I think we donate now to the best last count they gave me between myself and my companies, about 165 different charities. So what we do is my own personal charity, my family charity is one thing. We put millions of dollars into cause we believe in. Mm-hmm. Our schools, which donate millions of dollars every year, all of our students, and Paul Mitchell obviously also pitches in money, we get as a team, like, okay, Children's Miracle Network worked really good. We're helping the world out. Mm-hmm. And what we do now is we take the money that each school raises. Half the money stays locally. The other half helps the state, the country, or the world out. Mm-hmm. And what's wonderful is our students get to realize the joy of giving. Yeah. It becomes part of their life. Will any of our students ever meet these kids in Africa, for example, or some of the thousands of kids we help nationwide that never have to pay a medical bill because we're picking it up for them, or some of the other great things, the Sea Shepherd, other great things we do? No, but why do they do it? Because they know when you do something for somebody else, mm-hmm. you ask nothing in return. You get the greatest high, and it's a good way of life. Right. It changed our attitude among one another. It's a wonderful thing.
Absolutely. I think it's really important for people in general, but specifically hairdressers, mm-hmm. to learn about this in schools and to carry that on with them throughout their entire career.
Oh, yes.
And one thing I do wish that schools did have was teaching hairdressers more of the business side of the industry. Do you have like any recommendations for hairdressers as far as like how much money to invest into their business or into savings or how to have like a successful business doing hair?
Very good. Let me cover two areas. One, how to save money.
Yeah.
And number two, about business. We started a couple years ago business seminars, which are very, very, very successful, where a hairstylist or a salon manager or an existing salon can come in to our management training programs and get a training on how to run a salon properly, some of the things you have to know. But in our industry, there are so many things we could do. We could be a stylist and so many, I'm sure you're gonna address that, other things we do in our industry. So as they're going into it, they should start learning about balancing the books. The first thing is, if you have a checking account, balance your checking account. Every time you write a check, deduct it from what's in there so you don't have bounced checks.
Yeah.
But it's a good habit to start off very early. Mm-hmm. When a student, for example, in our industry first goes to work, they make very little money. Well, that's very hard to save. So what do you do?
Right.
It's a book I read many, many years ago about how to accumulate wealth. and be happy in life. Now, wealth doesn't mean millions or billions of dollars. It means wealth that you have enough money. If something comes up, you could go for it and eventually maybe one day own a house. Now, that's wealth. You own your own house, you got some money put aside, and you're happy and healthy.
Yeah.
Happy and healthy is the biggest wealth.
Right.
Well, how do we address these things? Mm-hmm. When you get out of school, because that's when you start making some money, yeah, or when you start doing anything in your life that's making money, take 5%, just 5%. When you get the check, let's say it's for $70, take 5%, $3.50, mm-hmm, and put it somewhere you're not gonna touch it. Right. The banks suck. They give you the worst interest in the world, but at least it's safe there. You could put it in a bank for now with little money, all right?
Right, yeah.
But don't touch it. And put it in a savings account, not your checking account.
Right.
Every time you get money, put it in there. When you finally get enough money that, you know, you're able to do that all the time, you're gonna realize something. If you took it out first, that 5%, and put it in the bank, all your bills are still gonna get paid. You're not gonna miss it. Mm-hmm. What most people do in life is they pay all their bills left. Let's see what's left. What can we do with this, or what do we still owe? So that's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, at the same time, if you could do it, don't use your credit cards. I know at first you've got to. Try to use them as little as possible and start paying cash for everything. A lot of people mortgage their future on credit.
Right.
And that's not the thing to do.
Right.
When you start your business, any kind of business, or get involved, do it the same way. Part of what you earn is yours to keep, and that's what it is. Mm-hmm. So most people work all the time, their entire check disappears in bills. Well, but you didn't pay yourself.
Right.
That little 5%, all of a sudden for me, as I started making money, not at first, then went to 10%.
Yeah.
And then it went from there.
That's amazing. And how much of your money did you reinvest into your business?
Well, with Paul Mitchell, every single penny we can get.
Yeah.
And then even after after 2 years, we made $2,000 each. Mm-hmm. We took exactly what it took to live off of, mm-hmm, and we didn't change for one more year, all stayed in the business. So even though we could afford to, let's say, raise our standard of living a little bit, mm-hmm, including a car, never owned a new car at that time, right?
Yeah.
I didn't own a new car till 1985, after we were in business 5 years, right?
Oh, wow.
So in other words, live below your means. So after the second year, I could have jumped up my standard a little, but I didn't. Mm-hmm. I kept it where it was at, which allowed us that extra year to have all the money in the business, pay off whatever bills had to be paid off,
right,
personally,
yeah,
and not just catch them up to date. And then the next year, I upped it a little bit, but never went beyond until a couple years later.
Yeah.
And that's a real secret. Too many people in the entertainment business, just in general life, mortgage their future with debt, and they shouldn't do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think it's really easy to do, like, especially with now, like, everyone kind of wants that, like, instant gratification of getting things right,
that's
away, right, when they may or may not be able to afford it. So I think it's really good to try and have that, like, self-control and, like, remember to, like,
that's
save
correct
for your future first, mm-hmm, because it takes money to invest in yourself, right? So let's say you've started your brand, you created, mm-hmm, your brand, you have your website, you have all your social media platforms covered. You are interviewing John Paul DeJoria in his office in LA. Mm-hmm. What's the next step when you have entrepreneur's block? Like, kind of like writer's block, but like entrepreneur's block? Like, what would you say is like the next step for like any entrepreneur when they're feeling stuck in a position and not really sure what the next step is?
No one has ever asked me that question. That's one of the best questions you could ever ask anybody. And don't edit this one out, okay?
Okay, guys, don't edit this out.
it would take me 1 hour and 29 minutes to tell you. My suggestion is this: for a couple of dollars, they could rent Good Fortune, okay?
Yeah.
If it's not one of the best films you've ever seen as an entrepreneur, I'll give you your few dollars back. Just tell me.
It's incredible.
Yeah, but I just go, and you could go online. YouTube has it, Amazon has it, and somewhere else there, but it's Good Fortune, the movie.
Yes.
Check that out, because it talks about going up, going down, being stuck, being without, being with, being fired, not being fired, being fired again, not being fired. It goes through the whole thing that, mm-hmm, lets you know that, you know, hey, no matter how bad things are, you keep on plugging away.
Yeah.
And when you see something like this, it unblocks you.
Yeah.
Another thing you could do too is in the morning when you wake up. We all wake up in the morning, and most of us, you know, maybe go wash our face or go to the bathroom, right? Go right back to bed again.
Ah.
And just sit up in bed, no TV, no music, obviously put the shades up so you've got light in the day. And for just a few moments, what I do is this: creator of souls, and I say it out loud, unless there's a bunch of people around, then I say it to myself,
yeah,
creator of souls, thank you for this life you've given me. I'm so grateful. And please show me the truth. Let me open myself up. And then I try and go blank. Now that's hard. mean, just like I sit there and back across the leg, I just try and go blank. So what I do to have just nothing in my mind is like a look at the wall. Okay, that's a wall. There's the window to go into present time. And now my breath is going into my nose. It's going down here. It's going back out again. I try and trace my breath. Every trick I can do to get me in present time. And even for 10, 15 seconds, if you're totally blank, almost like a meditation, you open yourself up to, let me call it universal energy, coming in. And then you start your day a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. You don't think about when you first get up, what's my appointment schedule, what I'm going to do, just blank your day out. It's amazing how things just come to you. And be open to the universe. Be open to things coming to you.
Absolutely. That is a great answer. I think everybody needs to hear that, including myself. So I always like to end my interviews with a gift. So I have a small little gift for you.
Oh, thank you. Well, let's check this out. Oh boy, all right.
So I figured, you know, you're riding your bike.
Oh, check this out here. This is
cool. You're down PCH in Malibu, you're hot and sweaty, you need to grab a t-shirt out of your backpack to change into. This can be your t-shirt.
Beyond Beauty School, there you go. Well, you'll see this more in Austin, because that's where I do most of my motorcycle riding in Austin, okay? But you'll still see that there more, that's for sure.
I'll have to go there to make sure I see you.
Oh, you'll have to. You say, I'm coming, I want to see that shirt. So this shirt is definitely going
with
me.
You let me know, I'll be there, we show up.
Oh, we'll go home.
So, question. So we all know the things that cosmetologists can do with their license in the beauty industry, but what are some things that other people can do in the beauty industry that don't have their license?
Like me.
Yes, okay. Just like you.
I worked for Time, Inc. before I went to work in the beauty industry, and my dear friend John Capra, whose wife had a salon, said, JP, there's an opening at this one professional hair care company. Now, you're not a hairdresser, but they're looking for someone in sales, but you could talk to people. You're going to love it. It's a fun industry. Give it a try. And I did. And obviously, I stayed with it, turned incredible. So in our industry, and like some people got out of beauty school, and maybe they're like, I am. I wasn't real talented at cutting hair. Paul tried to teach me because I haven't been to beauty school, right? I wasn't good. He said, JP, keep your daytime job. But in our industry, you've got people in sales, marketing, research, product development, art. We also have people working in the salon industry. Several of our school owners are not hairstylists, and they are school owners, okay? Mm-hmm. Several of the people that we deal with, in fact, quite a few of them, that are big distributors. Some are salespeople from the beauty industry. Some are hairdressers that later became distributors. Yeah. So in our industry, it's very, very open. And by the way, for hairstylists, another thing that's open that a very few hairstylists realize, besides working in a salon, and every city has this just about of any size, there's getting the movie industry. Let people making films know that, hey, I'm a hairstylist. I could do the film. I could do the makeup.
I could do local
stuff here. And at the same time, I could do a presentation for people. Mm-hmm. There's so much that comes out of this wonderful industry. So one keeps their eyes open. It's not just hairdressing with a license. It's so many other avenues. Receptionists, for example. Yeah. Some of the greatest receptionists on the planet aren't licensed hairstylists, but love the industry.
But there's a lot of, I mean, I've seen a lot of hairdressers transition from working behind the chair to corporate also. Yeah. And it's great for hairdressers that are feeling a little burnt out behind the chair but want to stay in the industry. Mm-hmm. But are doing something a little bit different. So
yes, and the opportunities are phenomenal. Yeah. For example, our executive vice president, chief operation officer, Jason Yates here, a hairstylist, had a salon, was a platform artist, entered the beauty industry, and now he is our, you know, like top guy up there. He's our chief operation officer, and he's brilliant.
That's incredible. Brilliant. Yeah.
And I would say at Paul Mitchell, quite a bit of the staff, if you walked around, are our hairstylists, okay, that work for us in various positions.
Yeah.
As well, and in the field, we have in the field as educators and as salespeople and marketing people, both hairstylists as well as students that came wanting just to work with us, okay? And of course, people that haven't been going through beauty school. So it's quite a thing.
I mean, I'm here to attest to that. I'm a journalist too. I'm sitting right in front of you, interviewing you. I would have never thought in a million years I'd have this opportunity. So
we should have included that. You could also be a journalist.
Yeah. You could sit right here and JP. Yeah.
Thank you for taking the time.
Thank you so much.
Anytime.
It's a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for joining us.